bulletins. There is seven things that were placed in the bulletin. And this is a critical juncture for the porch. We are challenged by the fact that given all that's happening in the world today, there is no doubt that Jesus is about to return. And so there is some ambivalence in my spirit because we are planning for 5 years, and I'm not so sure if the world will be standing at that time. But we must be about our Father's business. Amen. Until he returns. And so I'd like for you to bow your heads with me, and I will share just a few thoughts with you about what we believe God has commissioned us to do for the next 5 years. 2020. Our Father and our God, I ask that the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart might be acceptable in your sight. If I please heaven, then I know that I've done what you have called me to do. Let nothing in my life hinder this word from going forth, and nothing in the life of the hearer keep this word from finding fertile soil into which the seed of God can be deposited, planted, and will bear eternal fruit to the eternal glory of the eternal God, our King. It's my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. We've entitled the message for the morning, and when I say broken down into three parts, I'm going to present to you two visions at a time that I see God has placed on the porch for the next 5 years. We always ask you when you come to the porch or when you sit to hear the word of God that you do a few things. Number one, we always ask that you come into the presence of the Lord thirsty. The Bible says those who hunger and thirst after righteousness shall be filled. Then we ask that you come expecting. Expect a blessing from God. Expect a miracle from God. Expect something from God. We don't want the blessings to be simply a roll of the dice. We want us to have a purpose made up mind to leave this house of God today blessed. Then we always ask that you take notes. There should be an insert in your bulletin to do that. And then we also pray and ask that you pray throughout the service, not just once, but pray throughout the service, that God will create an atmosphere for the Holy Ghost to do something marvelous and miraculous today. Amen? Amen. We've entitled our message for the morning, God is trying to tell you something. God is trying to tell you something. People today are very busy, and it is very difficult to get someone to do just about anything that is outside of their daily routine. They are handling their business affairs, their finances affairs, their families, young children, school. And so it's really difficult to get folk to come into the house of the Lord and to do work for God, much less do something for you. You add to that that folk are not really people of their word. Folk will tell you at the drop of a hat that they'll do this and yeah. And then when it's time for the rubber to meet the road, you're on the road all by yourself. Nevertheless, it is easier to get someone to do something for you if either one, they have volunteered, or either number two, they have promised you that they're going to do it. When that happens, you might have a good chance of getting that thing done. And as I was thinking about what to preach about for the 6th anniversary, I prayed and I labored and I labored and I prayed, and I always look for that affirmation from the Holy Ghost to tell me what to say and to what to do that is appropriate, relevant, and applicable. And God simply told me one morning when I was in my study, He said, pray what has been promised. Pray what has already been promised. There are different types of prayers. If you don't know, there are different types of prayers. There are about 6 or 7, maybe 8 or more different types of prayers. One of them is the prayer of agreement. These are not my sermons, but if you're writing stuff down, they're a prayer of agreement. We touch and agree. We don't touch and agree on just anything. What is it that you want from God? I tell you what I want from God. I agree with you in the name of Jesus. There's an agreement prayer. Amen. We are not agreeing, we're not praying for peace all over the world. We are touching and agreeing on a particular thing. And then there is the prayer of praise and worship. David did a lot of that in the psalm. Just a prayer of praise and worship. God, I didn't come to ask you for nothing. I just come to praise your name. I just come to bless you. And it's in the form of a prayer. And there's a prayer of consecration and dedication. God, I give my heart to you today. And there is the intercessory prayer where I pray for you and I stand in the gap for your family and for your children and for Rylan and for children who have drug addictions and alcohol problems and bad relationships. I intercede for you. And then there's a prayer of binding and loosing. Binding and loosing. We loose and we bind in the name of Jesus. That's a type of prayer. Amen. And then there is the prayer of supplication. That's where you request things from God. And then there's the prayer of faith. Prayer of faith. Effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. The prayer of faith. And I want to give you an example of two types of prayers of faith. One was the prayer of Hannah. And the other was the prayer of Hezekiah. The prayer of Hannah was a woman who did not have any children. And she wanted children so bad that she went to the temple one day, and when she prayed so hard that Eli, the high priest, thought that she was drunk and approached her and said, drunk woman, what are you doing in the house of God? She said, I'm not drunk. If anything, I'm drunk in the spirit, but I'm not drunk. I want a baby and I want a child. But what's unique about that is that she said, I didn't want the child for myself. If you give me a male child, I promise you that I would give that child back to you. And so when the child was born, needless to say, she got pregnant, because God handles his business. She got pregnant and she gave that child back to God. And Samuel, the prophet, became a temple child. And then you have the story in 2 Kings chapter 20 of Hezekiah. So now you got the Hannah prayer, a mother who wants a child. She wants a child. She wants to be a mother. And then you got the prayer of Hezekiah. Now Hezekiah's situation is a little bit different, because Hezekiah was told that his time on earth was finished. Can I get somebody to help me a little bit here? Yeah. The prophet came to him and said that enough is enough. You've lived on this earth long enough. You've been king of Israel long enough. Now it's time for you to go home. Put your house in order, because you are about to die. And that's about the end of it, my friend. Isaiah turned around and got ready to leave. And while he was out in the temple court, the Bible says that he fell down on his face. And he cried and he wailed unto God. I don't want to die and I don't want to go anywhere. I want to live a little while longer. And so he put before God and remembers before God some of his accomplishments and what he has done and how he served God. And before Isaiah got out of the temple court, the Holy Ghost tapped him on the shoulder and said, go back and tell Hezekiah that I heard his prayer and I'm going to give him 15 more years to live. One was a mother who prayed and she one other child to give to the service of God. Here's a man who I consider it a really selfish prayer. He didn't say, I want you to extend my life so that I can rule your people. He just simply said, Lord, I paid my tithe. I did some stuff for you. I serve you and I worship you. And God heard his prayer. And God turned the calendar of death around. I don't understand all the theological implications of that, because I was told that whenever your time on earth is done, there is a check on the calendar and you're done. Somehow God turned back the hands of time. Somehow God took an eraser and just erased the date and said, you know what? I changed my mind. I heard your prayer. And he says, I'm going to give you 15 more years. The problem with that 15 more years is that Hezekiah ended up being a jerk. That's what my daughter calls me. My youngest daughter can call me that. Can't nobody else call me that. But my youngest daughter said, Dad, you're a jerk. But I'm still your daddy. And so one was a mother's prayer while the other was a king's prayer. One was for himself while Hannah's prayer was unselfish because she wanted to give her child to temple service. Hezekiah had lived his life and he was looking for an extension. Hannah was praying a promise, and that promise was be fruitful and multiply. What's my point? My point is that when you pray what God has promised, it is easy to get God to do certain things for you. And when I thought about what we're going to do here at Solomon's Porch for the next 5 years, 2020, that's what God told me. He said, Pastor Lewis, don't make it complicated. Don't make it elongated. Don't make it, no. Pray what I've already promised. So I started going through the Bible and I said, okay, well, what does the Lord promise? And then I said, give it to me, God. Then God says, I promise you this. In Matthew chapter 28, verses 18 through 20, the Bible says, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore. That's where I stopped. Go ye therefore. I've given you power so that you can go ye therefore. I have given you power so that you can witness to others. I don't give you power so that you can sit in church and simply have a good time. I give you power, therefore, go ye into all the world. So the first thing I'd like to say about Solomon's Porch 2020 is that I believe that God has given us power to do his will and to preach his word. Amen? Word of God ought to be so powerful and preached up in here until when it is preached, the devil gets so hot in the kitchen that he can't even stand to stay up in here, that he's got to get out of here because the word of God is being preached. Amen? We're not talking about fluffy stuff. We're not talking about soft stuff. We're talking about stuff that's going to get you into the kingdom. I've given you power. Understand that power is given to do the work of God. You don't need a Ferrari if you're not going to drive fast. You don't need a Shelby Mustang if you don't plan on putting the pedal to the metal. You don't need a $4.5 million Lamborghini if you don't plan on using the power. I want you to write this down. Power is given where power is needed. Did you hear that? Power is given where power is needed. If you're not doing anything for God, if you're not working for God, then you don't need power. A lot of us wonder why we are so weak and why we don't have power. As God says, you don't really need it. You're not doing anything. I wish I had a witness this morning. You're not doing anything that requires power. You play in church. You don't need power to play church. You don't need power to come and look good in church. You don't need power to come and style in church to show the latest hat or shoes or suit that you wore. You don't need power for that. Amen? All you need is a credit card to be able to afford it. You don't need power, though. Power is given where power is needed. And so when Solomon's Porch needs power, God will give us power. Start expecting big things from God. Start claiming big things from God. Stop giving God a small cup to fill, but give him a bucket to fill. God then said, you need power now. You don't need a Ferrari if you ain't gonna drive fast. Get you a Volkswagen. Get you a Beetle. Get you something else. Get a Hurst. But if you want to do work for God, Solomon's porch, God will give us power to do the work. That's number one. Number two, he said, let them make me a sanctuary that I might dwell among them. In Exodus chapter 25 and verse 8, when Israel came out of Egypt and they got out into the desert, God said, let them make me a sanctuary that I might dwell among them. The purpose of asking the saints of God. Last night, you were not here in our service. Last night, we had a wonderful presentation of our members, old and young, who said where they would like to see Solomon's porch in the next 5 years. Almost everybody inevitably said that they wanted to see us with a sanctuary. They wanted to see us with a wonderful, beautiful edifice. That's all fine and well. But the question you got to ask yourself is, why do you want to build a sanctuary and a temple for God? The Bible makes it clear why we ought to. He said, let them build me a sanctuary that I might dwell among them. If you're trying to build a temple for self-glory, if you're trying to build a temple to prove to Patmos, y'all, excuse me a minute. Yeah, excuse me a minute. If you're trying to build a temple to impress somebody, if you're trying to build a temple to let them know I'm still standing, if you're trying to build a temple to pat yourself on the back, if you're trying to build a temple and put folk in debt for maybe 20 or 30 years with a $2 million, if not more, church, you got to have a good reason for passing a debt on to our young folk who are 15 years old but will then be 20, who are 20 years old but then will be 25. Now you're asking them to pay the debt. Here is why you make me a sanctuary, that I might dwell. No, you ain't got it. You ain't, see, Holy Ghost always tells the preacher when they got it. Don't build a sanctuary to prove nothing to nobody. No, man, no, no. That's what a lot of mega ministries are doing. That's what a lot of churches are doing. They're building temples so that folk can see. God says, you've already got your reward. But if you build me a sanctuary that I might dwell among you in 2010, 2020, you'll have a sanctuary, and I'll help you pay for it. Yes. Amen? Yes. All power is given unto me because you got a work to do. There are folk that are out in the world who are hopeless. There are folk who did not want to wake up this morning because their day was so gloom and so hopeless until if they found the nerve and the courage, they would kill themselves. But God gave them another day of life. They need somebody to smile at them. They need somebody to pray with them. They need somebody to say that tomorrow is going to be a better day. They need somebody. And if you do that, God says, I'll give you power. And then he says, if you want to make a sanctuary that I might dwell among you, I'll give you all the money that you need in order to build a temple that will satisfy any ministry that you engage in. Did you hear what I just said? Those are the first two things. Amen? God, I need power. But I don't need power for myself. I need power to do your will and power to do your work. Oh, I want a sanctuary, don't get me wrong. But I ain't got a sanctuary just so I can show the folk over where we came from. Nah, 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 nah. God says, if that's why you want a temple, he said, then I'll get in the way. Yeah, hello? Or either I'll get out of the way. Yes, sir. I don't want to be among that situation. Those are the first two things that I believe that God has called us to do. First two things, power to go ye therefore. And then secondly, build a sanctuary that I might dwell among them. I want my preacher to come up and pray for those two visions. Remember, I told you that this sermon is in three parts. Amen? Yeah. We want to pray a commitment to our saints for power and purpose. And then we want to pray a dedication for the vision of building a temple to the glory of God.
I would ask that as far as possible that you would kneel with me, because we are serious about this vision. If it's possible, our most kind and gracious God, every breath that we take, every move that we make, is only because you have entrusted us with life. God, we as Solomon's porch, as your people, we come now before the throne of grace. We come asking that we may be emptied of ourselves and filled with power. Holy Ghost, power. That we may do the work that you have laid before us, God. We have come today because there are those who are so far away from you that they can't see the lighthouse. They don't know which way to go. They have no idea that there is a Savior and that he lives. You have placed us here, God, that we might build a sanctuary, that you may dwell among us, that the Spirit of God may fill the temple, and those who enter in may find rest and sweet rest. So God, we reach out today, calling for the Spirit to come, to anoint us, to refresh us, knowing that time is winding up, God. You have given us the commission to go forth, to tell those who are in darkness to see, to hear, to feel, to touch the miraculous one called Jesus the Christ. And so now, God, we humbly submit ourselves to you, coming home that you may place around our mingled, wretched bodies the robe of righteousness. We thank you for your blessings, and may they be many, may they be often, may they be refreshing. Thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, man of God. Thank you, man of God. Let me quickly give you the next two. Pray the promise, God told me. The next one he told me is in James chapter 1 and verse 27, where the Bible says, pure religion and undefiled before God and the Father is this, that you visit the fatherless and widows in their affliction to keep himself unspotted from the world. Now, very few churches have widow ministries. Yet the Bible tells us that we have a responsibility to minister to the widows. And so this is what God put in my spirit. He said, look, you need to create a widow's ministry. And then you also need to bless the fatherless. Now, oftentimes we'll see a child or a young woman who has about 3 or 4 children before she reaches the age of 20. And somehow we blame her and say she ought not have any more babies. You're right about that. But the fact of the matter is that the scripture never tells us how the person became fatherless. He simply says in scripture that we have a responsibility to help the fatherless. Y'all ain't with me now, y'all. It's the Father's Day coming up tomorrow. The father might be in prison. The father might have abandoned that family. It doesn't matter. God said that there is a ministry that you have in order to reach out to the fatherless. And I want you to bless and visit the widows who are in affliction. That's what God has called us to do. That's what God wants us to do. If you don't do that, listen to what the Bible says. Pure religion is this. So what it means is that if you're not doing this, your religion is not pure. Can I get somebody on this side to say amen? Yeah. Pure religion is this. Not singing in the choir. Not preaching good sermons. Not giving money to the church. That's not what pure religion is. Pure religion, James says, is this. Undefiled before God is to visit the fatherless. I can testify to that because in the black community now, there are so many fatherless homes. God, you must be talking about us. You must be talking about our community. That text must have been written for us because there are so many fatherless homes. Yes, fathers are jumping out and bailing out. Yes, you got a lot of no good, low down. Yes. But that's where we come in. Whatever situation the mother finds herself in, it never changes the situation of the child. That child's needs stay the same. Okay, all right. No matter how the woman became, how she became, no matter how loose she may be, no matter what you think about her, no matter how the child became fatherless, the needs of the child remains the same. So you want to know why our children act the way they act? No mentor there. You know why the children act the way they act? It's because we as men in the church have not stepped outside of the church. No, I ain't gonna preach long, so if you help me, Holy Ghost, I'll make it quick. Pure religion is this. Here's what we think pure religion is. Coming to church in fine clothes and nice cars. Nothing wrong with those things. That's not pure religion. Pure religion is undefiled before God. Visit the fatherless and the widows. If we're not doing that, Solomon's Porch, our religion has been clouded and tainted. Just say amen. You ain't got to really agree with me. Just say amen. Here's the fourth one. The Bible says the poor you will have with you always. Let me tell you how y'all built the previous Patmos. That though y'all are not enjoying it, somebody's still enjoying it. Let me tell you how you built the previous Patmos. When the poor came to your door, folk might have not liked how you did it. They may not have liked how much you did it. They may not have liked all of that. But the Bible says the poor you will have with you always. And because you all took care of the poor, you built that church. Well, guess how you're going to build this church? The formula is still the same. If you don't take care of the poor, God says, I'm not going to take care of you. Now, don't get it twisted now. The Bible did not say that the poor will always be poor. Oh, you need to Let me just step down on this one. I'll step one down and I'll talk. The Bible did not say that the poor has to always be poor. What we as a church ought to do is to empower people, not cripple people. The church is not a welfare center. The church is not a social service center. The church is an empowering institution. What we do is we help people do better. Not to keep on coming back over and over again asking. We need to stop them somehow and say, oh, wait a minute, how can I help you? I got a young man just yesterday sent me a text message from Africa, in South Africa. And his name is Wayne. And he said, Pastor, how you doing? He intentionally took a picture of him working on a truck. He's a mechanic now. When I was in Zimbabwe, he was not a mechanic. Things were bad. The economy was in shambles. He said, Pastor, I want you to help me go to school. So I gave him $300 to go to school with. Not only did he enroll in school, but things were so bad, he withdrew out of school, took the money back, and went and did something with the money. So when I found out about it, I said, I thought you were in school. He said, well, I was in school, Pastor, but I needed the money, and so I had to drop out, and I took the money, and I spent it. He said, but Pastor, will you give me one more chance and help me out again? Now, you know, now not most of us, Yeah, we done when he comes to the front door. Go tell him mama ain't home. But he sent me a picture, and he posed next to the truck where he was putting the brakes on or the transmission in or something that he was doing just yesterday. Because I heard him, and I said, listen, son, I gave it to you one time. I said, I don't normally do this. I said, but I'll do it again. I said, I'm going to help you. He said, Pastor, I promise you, I'll do better next time. Right. Now he is a full-fledged mechanic because somebody had confidence in him and somebody changed his life around and somebody put a little something into him. So you don't have to always be poor. But God has called us to reach out to the poor. God forbid that we forget where we've come from. Elder Humphreys, I love that you just said. Some of us forgot where we came from. Or just because you got a nice rose and a nice puff on your hat or wearing. No. You got to remember where you came from. Pastor, where you say you came from in Florida? Oh, yeah, Mariana. I know a little something about Mariana. You didn't know that, did you? They still got some shacks in Mariana. What I'm trying to tell you in a jovial manner so that you can swallow the pill is that God says we got a work to do, and that is to help the poor. Amen? That's why you go to school. That's why you have a job. It's to help those who cannot help themselves. The poor you will have with you always, but they don't have to stay poor. And then Jesus said something I love. The prayer in John chapter 17. Don't worry, I won't be long. Chapter 17. Jesus prayed a prayer that really is the Lord's prayer. The one that we say in Luke is the Lord's prayer. That's our prayer. He said, when you pray saying our Father. So that's our prayer, but we call it the Lord's prayer. No. The Lord's prayer is in John 17, where Christ said, I pray this for my disciples, that they may be one. That they what? That they may be one. Now, you think that's an easy prayer to fulfill? No. Let me walk up to you and don't speak like I'm Jamaican or don't speak like I'm Haitian or don't speak like I'm from the North or speak like I'm from the South. You ain't with me on that side. It's very easy to not be one. That's why Jesus prayed the prayer that they might be. I don't know where we get this thing, man, about Jamaicans and black Americans and Haitians and whoever's and whatever's. We got ethnic problems. We got color problems. We got folk that we don't even like because they got a little weight on them. They're a little big. They fat. We got problems if you're a little bit too dark or you're a little bit too light. Oh, y'all didn't know that? We got folks we don't like because they wear extensions in their hair. It ought to be natural because that's the way God. No, no, no. Some folk need a little help. Amen. I don't know where we as Adventists always talking against makeup. Oh, there's some folk I've seen them without makeup, and I say, look, excuse me, you need to. I think we were a little bit better than we were before. Sometimes we need a little help. And I'm not sure where we get this thing, man, about what anything divides us now. If I don't speak like I'm from one island. And if I'm from the South and I got a little twang, I'm a, y'all, you understand? We got the educated, don't like the uneducated. And then we got the educated that talk like they are not educated, and then you don't like them. And Jesus prayed a powerful prayer. He said, that we might be. What do I see in 2020, Elder? If we are not one, if we are divided, if we become tribal, if we become trifling, stay with me, stay with me, stay with me. I ain't got but one more. If we become trifling, if you're single and don't like folk because they married, you know, there's some folk mad at folk just because they ain't got no husband, they ain't got no wife, they just mad at folk because they married. How come y'all always happy? What you so happy about? Eh? Anything divides us. I don't like the way you dress. I don't like the shoes you're wearing. Something is too tight, and something is too loose, and something is too tall, and something is too short, and something is too big, and something is too small. Something is always. You know where people feel comfortable? Where they're welcomed? Where you're not like a little African monkey always picking stuff off of. Y'all ever see little monkeys? And then they be picking, you know, raking on each other? That's how you feel when you come to church sometimes. You come to church and it's like somebody picking something off you. Leave me alone. Leave me alone. Just let me get into the house of God before the throne of God. He'll fix whatever's not right. That was the prayer of Jesus, that they might be. Solomon's Porch. If we don't have a spirit of oneness, we're not going to make it. Oh, my gosh. The time is passing. The time is passing. The time is passing. And then I got number six. Y'all got a song for me, Elder? Y'all got a song for me? You got a song for me? Can I get a song for you before I do number six? Can I get a song for you before I get number six?
Choir.
Because number six is going to knock you off your feet. That's why I'm giving you a boot. The last one's going to knock you off your feet. Y'all give me something before I give them the last one. Help me, Holy Ghost. Help me, Holy Ghost.
about the blood.
Church, say amen. The blood will never lose its power. Hallelujah. Let me take 10 minutes and give you this last point to what I see Solomon's porch in the next 5 years. Now, the Lord gave me this one, and I want you to just stay with me for a moment. In Proverbs chapter 22 and verse 6. The Bible says, train up a child in the way that he should go. And when he is old, he won't depart from it. There is an inherent promise in this text. Here is the promise that if you train him up right in the way, then God says you give me something to work with in the future. Just stay with me now. Just stay with me. Just a minute. Now, the first thing Satan tries to do is because he cannot block the promises of God, no matter what he does. If you train them upright, God says, I'll get to them later on. So here's what the devil does. He says, oh, okay, I can't mess with the promises of God, so here's what I'm going to do. The Bible says, train them up when they get old. He says, if I can keep them from getting old. Let me repeat that. If I can keep your children from getting old, If I can get them in a drive-by shooting, if I can get them to OD on drugs, if I can get them to be walking zombies, if I can keep them from getting old, then the promise will never get to them. Oh, is that too deep for you? Train them up in the way that they should go. And then when they are old, God promises that I'll get to them. So Satan says, I can't affect the promise, so here's what I'm going to do. I'll keep them from getting old. Even if I got to go to South Carolina and walk up in church on Wednesday night, if I can keep them from getting old, then secondly, he works on the parents to minimize the importance of the power of this text and the promise. What are you saying, preacher? If you want to see how Solomon's porch is going to look in the year 2020, examine what you are doing or what you are not doing as a parent. See, that's why you got a preacher, because he can say some things that some other folk can't say. If you do not put importance on your children being in church or being, listen to me, or being instructed in the admonitions of the Lord, you are rolling the dice, hoping that in 5 years, your son who was 15 now, who will be 20 then, that he will have an interest in church. No, you don't get it. You think that this is just going to be automatic and by osmosis? That we're going to have a full house and your children are going to be in church in the next 5 years? If you don't do nothing about it today, if you don't do anything about it today, if you drive in front of church and drop your children off and you keep on going home, if you're not in church except for today, because it's a special occasion, I'll tell you where we're going to be in 2020. Your children will not be here in church. It's hard to get children to stay in church even when you train them up in the way. That's why the scripture says that train them in the way that they should go. Yeah, they'll go to the right, they'll go around the corner and down the alley and in the valley and over the mountain and get lost. But when they are old, that's for the person that's been taught. Where do you think your child is going to be? If you leave them to chance, I know I'm talking to somebody, preacher. Because here's what our interest is. We just want to make sure that our children are respectful. Wait a minute. We want to make sure that the goal is to make sure that our children are respectful. That's not the way. Oh, you don't get it yet? Watch this. As long as my child is not disrespectful, that's not what Jesus meant when he said the way. You know how many respectful children are joining Al-Qaeda and ISIS? Do you know how many respectful children are skinheads and white supremacists? You think that it's a roughneck, and he's got to have sagging pants on, and he got to be a thug in order. No. The devil has gotten smart now. It ain't the roughnecks. It ain't the rowdy. It's not the radical. It's the little child that's impressionable, who don't have the Holy Ghost and the seed of the word in his mind. And then when he hears something about hatred, and he gets his gun for his birthday. No, y'all not hearing me. You're not hearing me. That little young kid, what I saw on television, did not look disrespectful. He didn't look like he was rough. He didn't look like he was dangerous. Yet you want to be a parent whose goal is to make sure that your child is not disrespectful. Your child needs Jesus. They had the little kid that was coming to Detroit, or coming from Detroit or to Detroit, and they found a gunpowder and explosives in his underwear that was sewn by the militias, by the extreme Muslims. And if it wasn't for somebody, if it wasn't for God, because he pulled the thing and it didn't go off. But he was a respectful kid. You want to know where we're going to be in 2010, in 2020? Look at where you are today. If you don't have interest and commitment, if you don't understand that God, through South Carolina and through Colorado, theory of killing is trying to tell you something. You are not going to take this thing seriously. And your children will be the ones that are over in Afghanistan somewhere. And you thought, not my kid. Every parent that I've talked to said they never knew that their kid was capable of doing what they did. Not my boy, I raised him right. Yeah, but he didn't know Jesus. Get serious about this thing. Stop dropping your children off. Get up in here. You know, y'all ain't got to say amen. I know it's the truth. Might not be the best anniversary sermon in the world, but yeah. Let me tell you the benefit of knowing Jesus. Elder, you told me a story yesterday about how you lost your way, and you got a record that still stands now for being one of the fastest. Are y'all still with me now? For being one of the fastest in high school. Sit on down, Elder. That was back then. I'm just trying to make you look good. You gonna mess my sermon up if you stand up, Elder. I'm saying you were slim and trim, and you were fast and flash back then. You got a record that still stands to this day that nobody has broken. And even though you went to law school and you started drinking and you acted a fool for a while, it was what Mike Sr. put in your heart, and that was Jesus, that when you got older and you came to yourself, God has something to work with. Parents, if you don't put something in your children, and God tries to put the fishing pole out there and reel them in, there's nothing to hold on to. But if Jesus is in there, maybe a hook will get in there somehow. And when he's finished in prison, and when he's done with the streets, and when he finds himself flat on his back, maybe he'll call on Jesus. It used to be, I'm closing now. I'm about to close now. It used to be where trouble was only on CNN. And as long as it was on CNN, we were all right. We pray for the folk and way over there and way over there. But now other people's pain is coming closer to us. And now it's in our school. Where's Sister Tammy, who was in school and teaching, and all of a sudden the shots rung out on the playground and somebody had come up into the school and started shooting at somebody else. is trying to tell you something. You think you're safe in church now. The devil says, if I can't get you out there. Y'all don't understand what I'm saying. Look, if he'd have came in with gold all in his mouth and pants all down and sagging with tattoos, I guarantee you he wouldn't have shot very many people, because the moment he came through the door, somebody would say, look like trouble is in the house. Y'all. Hey, deacon, get on your job. But when they come in looking respectful, that's not your goal. That's not your goal. Respectful is not your goal. It's a good thing. That's not good education. That's not your goal. Train up your children in the way. Stop taking this thing lightly. The enemy comes to steal, kill, and to destroy. And I wish I could line all of my young people up right here to let you know that in the next 5 years, as hard as you try to put a vision up there, the devil said, I got something for you and you and your daughter and her body and his mind and your son and your. And you messing around. You got your children out on the playground on Sabbath. You messing around. You got your children doing everything except that which will save them. Train up your child. Ain't got to say amen. Train up your child. Let me give you some news here, and then I got something for you. If your child is named Palingo, if your child is named Mike, if your child is named Lewis, if your child has a last name, accent, you done put something in them children. Stay with me. You put something in them children. And no, you might only come to Solomon's Porch once or twice or three times a year. But I don't care what you do, and I don't care where you go, and I don't care what kind of fool you make of yourself. God has got something in you. God has got something in you. And goodness and mercy will follow you all the days of your life. Yeah, I've cursed my children. They're preachers' sons and daughters. Yeah, there's a spiritual heritage that they ought to embrace. My children can't do any and everything. They can't. Because they got the way in them. Can I talk to you? This thing is serious. Our children are bound up and they need to be set free. The old heads, elder, in 5 years, I don't know, elder, maybe senior won't be within this anymore. Sister Palingo, maybe she won't be with us anymore. I don't know. I pray not, but the reality of life is 5 years is a short time, but a long time. And they may not be with us. But these children. Help me, Jesus. These children that watch men come in your house like a revolving door. That's not the way. That's not the way. That's not the way. Oh, y'all didn't think I was. That's not the way. When your children got to grab you on Sabbath morning and say, Mama, Daddy, are we going to church? And you say, not today, son. We need to set our children free. Are you ready for us? We need to break the chains that bind our children so that the way can get up in them. Give God something to work with. Give God something to work with. Get up off your gluteus maximus. and give God something to work with.
I hear
the chains
I don't care if it's drugs. I don't care what it is. I don't care if it's sex. I hear it. I hear the change. You need to claim this for your children. Some of them out there trying to make Benjamins and money, but I hear the change falling. Whatever they might be caught up in the name of Jesus, Bishop, I hear it. That's the prayer of intercession, the prayer of binding and loosing. The Bible says, I hear the I claim that for our children today. If they're going to be a Solomon's porch that's worth existing, we've got to claim this today. Let me say this, Bishop, before I go. Let me say this, Bishop. I was last night listening to Boomerang. You know the Boomerang? I wasn't watching the movies. I was trying to get my sermon stuff together. And something came to my mind, and I went on YouTube, and I'm not going to play it today, but I had to find something because something stuck in my mind. And it was when Eddie Murphy went out and did something that he shouldn't have been doing, and he didn't come home that night when he should have came home. And when he came up in there to be with Halle Berry, she said, "Where you been?" And he said, "Well, I was out, and I had to, you know, clear my mind." And he said, "You were with Jacqueline, weren't you?" He had to say, "There's some things you just can't get past." And he said, "There's something you don't understand," he was telling Halle Berry. He said, "You don't understand that sometimes love, you don't understand what love is all about." And she said, "I'm sick and tired of you men talking about love like it's some type of disease that you catch or some kind of cold that you catch." She said, "You don't know nothing about love." She says, "If you knew something about love, love would have brought your home last night."
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I'm tired of Christians in the church talking about "I'm born again." I'm tired of you telling me how much you love God. If you love God, love would have brought you in church when you ought to be here. I grew up an Adventist, and I grew up a Pentecostal, and I grew, no. Stop throwing this love thing and conversion thing and "I'm a Christian" thing around. If you love God, it'll bring your home. If you love God, do something about it. You're a Christian, do something about it. It ought to bring you home. Oh, this is my appeal now. If you love God, if you claim you're a Christian, if you got something up in you, do something about it. Do something about it. Love ought to bring your gluteus maximus up in church on Sabbath or Sunday to hear the word of the Lord. That's the least you can give God. Learn from somebody else's pain. South Carolina, a few days ago. It could be in your house tomorrow. And now we're going to call on the name of the Lord. On our back, come preacher, come pray for me. It's time to come home. I gotta close this out. Father, in the name of Jesus, you trying to tell us something. We ain't listening. We think that there are certain things in life that are more important than getting to know you. We think that where we are and where we work, we got there on our own. When in the Lord, all you got to do is blow on our jobs, blow on our car, blow on our home, blow on our health. And the next thing we know, we're calling on Jesus because we don't have an answer for what we're going through. But God, it's in moments like these that you talk to us. It's in moments like these that you speak. It's in moments like these that we hear. Take your home from off the sand that's going to sink. reconstructed and put it on the rock that will last forever. That's all I got to tell you. If you're not in Christ, if you're not practicing what you preach and what you know and what you've been taught when you were young, you're on sinking sand. Now relocate your home and put it on Christ, the solid rock. That's what you need to do here today before we go home. Anybody here today want to put their homes on the solid rock? Anybody here today? I'm talking to you. I'm talking to you. You want to put your home on the solid rock. You want chains to be broken. Come on now, folks. Come on now, folks. I'm not going to ask you to come back this afternoon. I'm not asking you to come back tonight. You're going to eat and go home and you can relax. But right now, let the Holy Ghost work. I hear the chains falling. Oh, yeah. I hear the chains falling. Oh, I hear the chains falling.
Run them, run them, run them.
Oh, Lord, I hear the chains falling. We might not make it to 5 years. We're planning. We may not even make it. You could be at work, you could be on your job, you could be at your school, and next thing you know, some respectful, some not so rough looking person has come up in there, and that's what happened at Sandy Hook. The little children were in kindergarten. They were in kindergarten, for God's sake. They were in kindergarten. And some nut come up in and if you are not, folk, if you've drifted from Christ, I don't care what your last name is, don't let me close this service without you putting your house on the solid rock, because God is trying to tell you. Let me get up here so I can talk to you. Folk, whatever you're doing and whatever you're going through, it's not worth it. It's not worth it. Whatever you're doing and whoever you're doing it with and whatever direction, it's not worth it. And there may never be a stronger and more opportune time than today. Break the chains. Break the chains. Oh, Lord, I hear the break the chains. Get up and come down. Break the chains. Don't worry about tomorrow. I know you might be saying, well, you know what? If I stand up today, what if I mess up tomorrow? Tomorrow might not come. You need to do what you need to do today. Oh, I hear the. I'm gonna give you a couple of more minutes to take your stand and come on back home.